Dear students, welcome to APG Pathsala. In today's module, the title is Role of Meteorology in Aviation. Under this module, we will be in a position to discuss and cover the topics related to aviation and how the meteorology has been exploited in bringing the aviation activities. In the course of the module, you will be in a position to learn the importance of and indispensability of the meteorology in aviation, the role of meteorological parameters on the safe conduct of flights, the impact of severe weather phenomena in aviation, and the ways and means to avoid it, the meteorological instrumentation that are used for aviation, and above all, how best the economic benefit will be reaped out of meteorology in aviation activity. So, in order to understand better, we should know what is meteorology and then what we are going to see and relate the weather parameters and its role on meteorology, especially for the aviation operations. Meteorology as such is a complex science, as all of us are aware. It takes input from different streams, right from physical sciences of mathematics, physics, chemistry, geology, geography, and everything else. And it takes the technology into account, and it avails the technological benefits also every now and then. The right hand side view graph, what you are seeing, the basic physical sciences, technology, how they are contributing to the meteorological and atmospheric phenomena science. Meteorology as such, we will be saying that it is a study of day-to-day atmospheric condition and the processes caused in the atmosphere. The study of weather and climate is another area wherein meteorology is understood to be having a huge role. By weather, we will be in a position to say it is an instantaneous sum total of temperature, humidity, wind, the pressure, visibility, clouds and associated precipitation and associated weather such as thunderstorm, hailstorm, snow, lightning related phenomena. As all we know, weather varies from place to place and also from time to time. Weather has direct implication on every phase of aviation operation. Now, coming to the climatology, it is the long term average of a huge area, not necessarily on a spot. That is the distinction between the weather and climate. So, climate is the long term average. By long term average, I will be saying that it is a minimum of 30 years or so. The climate also changes from area to area, and climate varies with time. The climate parameters are useful in aviation to design an airport as well as for the aircraft operations. Now, coming to the role of meteorology in aviation, the meteorological data and information, especially the forecasts and warnings, they have the prophylactic value. What I mean to say the prophylactic, the moment we use these particular information, it will be of huge help, especially in the safe, effective and efficient conduct of flights. A flight in its all phases, by phases I mean, it is the takeoff and then climb out, then it will be cruising at a particular level, then thereafter it will be descending and ultimately it will landing at the destination. So, all these stages depend on the meteorology, especially the weather parameters. For example, the takeoff and landing phase of operation, they are purely affected by the change in wind, temperature, visibility, cloud, and if at all any weather phenomena which is causing disruption. Whereas in the case of in-flight or cruising operation, not only the weather phenomena like thunderstorm or hailstorm or cyclonic storm they affect, it is rather devising a way how best we have to mitigate such a severe weather phenomena in order to have a safe flight. As such, the meteorological input is necessary at every stage of operation. The met information helps the airlines, the airport operators, to plan the desired time of operation, that is what we call as expected time of departure, and how much payload they are supposed to take care of, and the path which by which you know they will be avoiding the severe weather phenomena, what is the amount of reserve fuel they are supposed to carry, and in case the destination is likely to be affected or not conducive for landing, what could be the alternate aerodrome and what could be the landing weight. These are all the information the met parameters are supposed to provide for safe conduct of the flight by the airline operator as well as the airport operator. Even a small minor change in operation, that will be having a huge role in aviation operation. To understand the aviation operation, we should first understand the Bernoulli's theorem based on which the aircraft takeoff is taking place. When airflow flows over an aerofoil, it is accelerated upward and a high pressure is created beneath. With this only the taking off is taking place. While taking off, it has two components resolved. One we call as lift, the another one we call as drag. The lift is directly proportional to the density and directly proportional to the square of the air velocity. When we say density, it is again indirectly related with temperature, humidity and pressure. When I say the air velocity, it is the velocity with which the aircraft moves against or with the prevailing wind. So, the surface wind is also playing a role in lift. Similarly, the drag also being influenced by the met parameters. As such, the parameters which are observed by the met department for the safe conduct of the flight, every stage met parameters having a key role. At the time of takeoff, the lift has to exceed the total weight, then alone the lift operation will take place. Besides this, the thrust has to be exceeding the drag. Whereas in the case of cruising level, all the four forces, that is lift, weight, thrust and drag, they should be in balance. Now coming to the role of surface wind. The headwind is favorable for both takeoff and landing operation. By headwind, what we mean? The wind which is blowing against the direction of the aircraft operation. Once the takeoff is taking place, the tailwind, the wind which is in the same direction of that of aircraft operation, will be favorable. As we can understand why I am saying favorable, because it will be resulting in fuel saving. The wind observations are also used for selection of the runway, that is what I have mentioned in the climate, the climatological science. So, based on the long period of average, the runway orientation shall be decided. The landing is normally not favorable. Wherever there is a crosswind or whenever there is a tailwind exceeding a threshold limit. By crosswind we mean the wind which is almost at 90 degree or perpendicular to the aircraft operation. No landing operation will be allowed when a crosswind component exceeds 25 knots. much more than this, if there is a strong tailwind, which will be rather pushing the aircraft which is coming down and the landing in the same direction, thereby, you know, there will be some casualty and operations. The strong tailwind exceeding 50 knots is not at all considered safe. In the recent time, thanks to technology, when the aircraft body has grown very wide and big, as much as 35 knots is considered to be the deadline above which no aircraft can land or take off in the tailwind condition. In addition to these winds, there are some gusty winds which blows in a erratic fashion, rises ups and down with minimum time. So that is also not conducive for the aircraft operations. Now let us talk about the role of surface temperature in aviation operations. By temperature, what we mean is the degree of warmth. The temperature, when it is rising high, it affects the engine performance. Higher the temperature, the density will be lower, which in turn resulting in low carrying power of the aircraft. And in order to compensate that one, we should have a lengthy runway, then alone the speed can be increased upon. If the runway length is insufficient, the alternative is that in order to gain the same stalling speed, we have to reduce the weight. As an example, a 2 degree rise in temperature will be causing offloading of cargo load or payload, or even sometimes passenger also have been offloaded. So that is why the International Civil Aviation Organization, they have given a guideline that whenever there is a rise of 2 degrees Celsius temperature, we have to give a cautioning signal, thereby the aircraft operations can be either postponed or can be deferred with. Now coming to the sensors which are used for the temperature, the conventional thermometers which have been shown in the figure, then a handy instrument called psychrometer which gives the ambient air temperature as well as the wet bulb temperature when the thermometer is having a thread which is linked with the water. Then the electronic sensors such as thermistor, Duesel, hygrister, a combination of all. The next parameter which is of paramount importance is atmospheric pressure. By pressure we mean it is the force acting on the unit area, and all these aviation operation, they are not confined only to the domestic, so aviation operations are spread throughout the world. So that is why international standard atmosphere has been defined. With this definition, we assume the pressure at the main sea level as 1013.25 hectopascal at a mean temperature of 15 degrees Celsius with a density of 1.225 kg per meter cube. For flying, the altitude has to be defined. Such an altitude is called as the pressure altitude. It is defined as the height corresponding to the pressure in the standard atmosphere which we have just now defined. For flight planning purposes, the deviation from the standard atmosphere have to be reckoned with. For every increase of 100 feet pressure altitude, depending on the type of aircraft like Boeing 707 or 747, we need to offload 500 kg or 900 kg respectively. The sensors used for pressure are the conventional mercurial barometer, then a miniature version called aneroid barometers and baroswitch, then digital pressure indicators. The third parameter, MET parameter, which is of relevance, is cloud. Cloud can be conceived as a conglomeration of condensed water particles. It is an aggregation of all the droplets which have been condensed, not necessarily water particle alone, because the clouds will be having some ice particles also. In dry areas, not necessary with water arise, it can contain some of the dust particles also. Depending on their base, height, shape, texture, structure, color, the clouds are classified as low, medium, high. The low clouds have height range somewhere between, whose base will be from surface to 3 kilometer, and the clouds in this particular low category are called stratus, stratocumulus, cumulus and nimbus stratus. The medium clouds have the base somewhere in the range of 3 to 6 kilometer, and such clouds are known as altocumulus and altostratus. The high clouds are having the base atop 6 kilometer, and it can go even up to 18 kilometer or so. The examples for this category is cirrus, cirrocumulus and cirrostratus. Notwithstanding these three types of clouds, there are clouds which cover right from surface up to 18 or 20 kilometers. Those clouds are having or being known as towering cumulus with a height of 5 kilometer, and cumulonimbus, anything beyond 6 kilometer. In the tropics, the cumulonimbus grow as high as 20 to 22 kilometers. Now, these clouds may be associated with precipitation or may not be. The clouds which are associated with the precipitation, it can be either vertically growing or may be in the stratiform type. The cloud which are growing on a vertical extent, like cumulonimbus or towering cumulus, they will be having updraft and downdraft movement and associated turbulence. These clouds will be having the electrical phenomena as well, which we call as lightning. The clouds are paramount importance for aviation because it obscures our visibility, especially when the dark threatening clouds with rain and thunder showers are there, our ability to see a far off place, which we call as visibility, is drastically reduced. The base of the height can be assessed by way of experience through naked eye, or there is an instrument called ceilometer which gives the base of the height, base of the cloud height, especially the low clouds. By visibility we define, it is the farther distance with a person of normal vision and sight will be in a position to see and distinguish an object of suitable dimension against the scattering background. The weather phenomena which affects the visibility are fog, mist, thunderstorm and sandstorm, dust storm, then heavy showers and associated precipitation. Fog can be conceived as a cloud at or near the surface which reduces the visibility to normally less than 1000 meter, about which we will be again covering in one more slide. As low as 10 meter visibility is also quite possible with fog. Transmissiometer is the instrumentation which is used to estimate the meteorological optical range, which is more or less equivalent to that of visibility and runway visual range. We will be defining what is runway visual range in the next slide. There is one more instrumentation which is used for visibility and related parameter measurements, that is called as forward scatterometer, and then this will give you the meteorological optical range, and this particular instrumentation is used in most of the unattended automatic airports. Now, coming to the runway visual range, it is the range over which a pilot of an aircraft, when he lands at the central line of the runway, will be in a position to see the edge markers or delineate the central line from the scattering background. As a practice, RVR has to be reported whenever the general visibility is less than 1500 meters. Now, with the technology improvement, we are able to operate even the visibility as low as 50 meters by way of automated instrumentation and trained pilots on this particular category. So, the picture which is shown here, it is the transmission meter, and the right hand side view graph is the dual baseline. By dual baseline, what I mean, one transmitter is there, there are two receivers. The distance between the transmitter and receiver is called as the baseline. In this view graph, the transmitter and the first baseline is 10 meters distance only. The second receiver is placed at 75 meter. The principle behind this is the transmitter emits a light of known power and it is being received at the receiver. Due to the atmospheric obscuration phenomena, the light is getting diminished at the time of reception, and with that, through our principles of optics, laws such as Allard and Cosimeter, we will be in a position to estimate what could be the transparency of the atmosphere, which ultimately we will say meteorological optical range, MOR, that is the theoretical postulation. Further defining this way, from the MOR, we will be in a position to estimate what could be the RVR, that is runway visual range. The right hand side figure is the ceilometer, which gives the height of the base of the low cloud atop this instrumentation. Here, the known source of laser beam is emitted to the sky and it is getting reflected by the base of the cloud. Thereby, we will be in a position to assess the base of the height of the base of the low clouds. This ceilometer is giving the parameter called vertical visibility or ceiling. The vertical visibility is important for the pilot because on reaching this particular height, then alone he will be in a position to see clearly where the airport is and then where is the runway. So, ceiling is the limitation, and whenever a pilot is given the vertical visibility, so he will be much more cautious at the time of landing. In a nutshell, the instrumentation whatever we have discussed have been projected in this particular slide. So, what are all the parameters and then what are all the sensors that have been coined over here? What we have not so far discussed is item number 6, 7 and 8 and 9, the weather radars that rather probes the atmosphere, especially the rain bearing clouds, convective clouds, cyclonic storm, and the phenomena like wind shear and turbulence, it will be in a position to detect. Light emission, light information, that is also playing a role in atmospheric optics. That is why we reaped this particular optical phenomena benefits, and a new instrumentation called LIDAR, light detection and ranging. This gives how the wind shift is taking place along the glide path, which is nothing but the path through which the pilot will be in a position to land at the touchdown zone of the airport concerned. Then, for landing, prior to that, the pilot needs to be controlled by the air traffic control, for which the wind at the upper level plays a vital role, that is being given by the radio sound, radio wind, GPS sound nowadays. So, with this wind information, the air traffic controllers will be vectoring the aircraft for the safe destination. Now, I am just taking you a glimpse of what are all the weather hazards affecting aviation. We already discussed something about the convective family like thunderstorm, tornado, cyclones and dust storm, sandstorm. I am combining all, the reason being the thunderstorm, tornado, cyclone, hailstorm, etc. They and dust storm and sandstorm, they are of the similar category, but for the only difference that in the first category it is having moisture content more, whereas in the case of dust and sandstorm the moisture is not that favorable, otherwise the impacts are remaining the same, especially on turbulence. The next important weather hazard is associated with the wind shear. By wind shear we mean it is the change of wind. By wind it is already we are knowing it is a vectorial component, both having the dimension as well as the direction. So the change in the direction and the change in the magnitude, that is what we call as dimension. So this plays a vital role, especially in the landing and takeoff operation, for which we just now said the Doppler weather radar, terminal Doppler weather radar, LIDAR are the instrumentation used. The next category of the weather element is precipitation, which rather blocks or obscures the vision of the observer or even the pilot, so thereby the visibility is hampered. So that is why this also is considered as a severe aviation weather hazard. Then comes the aircraft icing, about which we are going to study much more. So this is rather playing a vital role, especially when the carburetor intake is being affected. Then comes the turbulence. So here we have a lengthy discussion. Then comes a mountain wave and fog. Now coming to the thunderstorm, whenever a thunderstorm is occurring or passing over an airport, we normally feel there is a jarring sound which may be at the order of 60 to 100 decibels or so, and thereby it is causing a noise pollution. It is also associated with the flash of light, which is called as a blinding vision. When a pilot is venturing into that thunderstorm, normally he will not do. So his vision will be spoiled, that is the reason he always avoids thunderstorm. When an aircraft is venturing into a thunderstorm, again I am saying normally they will not venture, they will try to avoid only. By some mean if they venture into a thunderstorm, onboard instrumentation like analog and digital meters, they malfunction because there is a high surge in voltage which may be as high as 3 megavolt per meter as PDF. In thunderstorm, there will be bumpy and turbulent movements, and which will be causing hindrance to the passenger as well as the aircraft will be losing an altitude. By chance, had there been another aircraft going below, so they will be having a mid-air collision. All the thunderstorms, when they rise, normally you know they go even up to 18 or 22 kilometers, as I said. The water particle will solidify, ice crystal will form. Ice will be snowballing effect, that is what we call as ice will be accreting itself, and a hailstone will be formed. The hailstone, which is moving with a velocity, with mass and velocity, which we call as momentum. So that momentum causes denting in the aircraft. So that is also a severe weather phenomena. Now coming to the precipitation, when a heavy rain is there, the runway is flooded with rainwater. Normally there will be tapering. The right hand side second picture, if you see, an aircraft is just landing over a small thickness of water, and had it not been properly friction level maintained, this will cause the aircraft to have slippery condition. And there are cases which I have shown in the down below picture, due to slippery runway an aircraft has met with an accident. If not an accident, there can be incident also in the case of precipitation. The precipitation forms can be of different types, right from drizzle up to shower, hailstones, snow and freezing levels. The impacts we already discussed. When the precipitation is in the form of solid ice, and if an aircraft is flying at the time, the solid ice causes some weight, and then with that there can be even imbalance in the structure. The next category of the aviation significant weather is turbulence. This is one of the oldest unsolved problem in the classical physics. There are famous scientists like Einstein, Lamoureux, Fignon. These scientists, when they were given an opportunity to choose to work on their PhD thesis, they chose some other topic rather than turbulence they had recorded in writing, because it is an unsolved problem as of now, and it is a typical example of nonlinear dynamics. And turbulence is one of the hardest elements to be either modeled or parameterized. Whatever knowledge we have due to experimentation, with that we are in a position to give even an adequate warning on turbulence, though the accuracy depends on the actual encountering by the aircraft in regard to space and time. The turbulence can occur either in convective form, or the orography induced, or even with the change of wind, especially in the monsoonal conditions. The impact of the turbulence can be the bumpiness of the aircraft, irregular and chaotic motion. By turbulence, what do you mean? What are all the causes for it? And then what is causing it? It is based on the instability as well as the kinetic energy form of dissipation. The thermoturbulence is arisen out of steep lapse rate and convective plumes. The mechanical turbulence is caused because of the roughness of the surface and kinetic energy dissipation. The next category of the turbulence is mountain wave induced, that is orography induced. The third category is clear air turbulence. By clear air turbulence, what we mean? It is the turbulence which is seen in the clear air, but not in the vicinity of the convective clouds. What do I mean by this one? The turbulence which is seen in the CB clouds are not called as catch. The neighborhood of CB, there can be some difference in the wind speed, thereby the wind shear is arisen, thereby the kinetic energy is changing, and then that particular category in the vicinity of the convective clouds is not at all categorized as catch. The favorable locations are near the jet stream, because by the jet stream itself we have the definition it is a wind shear. The locations of the tropopause break, and over the extratropic it is the blocking high and omega blocking region. In this view graph, the four contributory mechanisms of turbulence are shown. As of now, we understood the convective currents because of up and down motion, it causes the turbulence, the first category. Coming to the number two, jet stream. By jet stream, we go by the definition, it is a strong narrow current of wind concentrated on a quasi horizontal axis, extending for thousands of kilometers in length, few tens of kilometers in breadth, few kilometers in depth, with a vertical wind shear of 5 to 10 mps per kilometer, with a horizontal wind shear of 5 mps per hundreds of kilometer, with a velocity minimum of 60 knots. So, as such, the vertical wind shear, which is 5 to 10 meter per second or 10 to 20 knots per kilometer, that is rather causing the severe up and down motion. The third category is mountain wave, that is orography induced, about which we are going to see an animation as well. The fourth category is over the airport, that is called as wake turbulence. This also I am going to see, we are going to discuss in a better way. In this animation, you can see that atop the mountain, on the lee side of the mountain, there is a wave induced, and over that, if an aircraft flies, how they are experiencing the bumpiness up and down motion. So, the mountain waves usually form on the lee side. The favorable conditions we are going to see in the next slide, and the identification an experienced pilot on seeing A capping cloud over the mountain itself suggests that on the lee side there will be orography induced turbulence. The clouds which are associated with the turbulence, they are of a typical shape which we used to call as lenticularis, lenticular clouds, which will be having almost like a lens shaped clouds, that is usually occur over the ridge region on the leeward side. When the wind blows almost at right angles to the orientation of the mountain, it tries to rise and thereby it is just crossing the peak of the mountain. It continues to rise. Due to the gravity and other pulling etc., it tries to fall. So thereby a sinusoidal wave pattern is created on the lee side of the mountain. The favorable condition at which it occurs, when the wind is directly hitting the mountain orientation, that is what I said, almost 90 degree, though exactly 90 degree is always feasible because wind is not like a rock steady arrow or something like that, it has aberrations, it has undulations. So anywhere between plus minus 30 degree at right angle to the orientation of the mountain, if the wind speed is exceeding 30 knots at a height, especially in the western ghat, which is normally varying between 0.6 and 1 kilometer. So at this height, if the wind speed is the order of 30 knots, one can anticipate on the leeward side of the western ghat of India, the mountain wave induced turbulence. It is induced over or at the airport itself. How it is formed? When a big aircraft lands, it pushes the air on either side of the runway, and that particular air, because the aircraft is landing at a high speed, even at the time of landing, depending on the type of aircraft, it will be somewhere at the order of 200 to 700 kmph. So that is why the air will be pushed aside on either side of the runway, and thereby the wind will be whirling, churning, rotating, almost resembling that of a tropical cyclone. The picture we are seeing now, it is a pseudo color image taken by NOAA, though we cannot see as such in the airport with a naked eye. With high sensitive instrumentation that has been captured and then pseudo color has been given for our easy understanding. The wake turbulence, what we mean is, whenever we say wake, it is aftermath, passover. When we say wake thunderstorm, a thunderstorm has passed over. When we say wake vortex or wake turbulence, the turbulence is already felt or the vortex is already seen in the wake of it, that is aftermath of the vortex. A bigger aircraft has caused the air on either side to go around and then whirl and churn, and a subsequent aircraft, if it is a lower body, it will be topped aside, it will be even flipping. There are accidents in association with the wake vortex. Identification of the wake vortex is a problem as on date because it is very, very minute and the instrumentation resolution is not that powerful so far. Nevertheless, the recent time on experimentation basis, Doppler lidars tuned for this particular phenomena are being ushered in to identify. But going by the earlier accidents and experience learned, the pilots have been taught in the classroom lecture, ATC have been governed with the procedure by the ICAO, that whenever a bigger aircraft is allowed to land, a smaller aircraft will not be allowed to land in the next 2 minutes or so, because we know the dissipation rate of this wake vortex and we know the powerful mechanism with which the bigger aircraft might have left behind around the airport. In addition to that, though we are unable to see on the instrumentation, we can hear a small whistling and roaring sound whenever a wake vortex is taking place. The next category in the aviation severe weather hazards is the aircraft icing. You can see how ice has settled over the body of the aircraft on both top and bottom figure. So the ice, rather, once it is formed, it is blocking the air intake which is needed for the engine performance. It blocks the carburetor. when ice is formed or when the flight is on its crucial phase, that is cruising level, the weight and then imbalance mechanism is acting on. When the ice forms over the surface itself, especially in the extratropical latitude airports and then high altitude airports in India, it causes the reduction in the lift, and thereby we have to spend more fuel and energy, and then we have to make the de-icing equipments active. Fortunately, all the modern aircrafts, they are fitted with the de-icing instrumentation, which rather melts the ice. The last category on the aviation severe weather phenomena is fog. As of now, we all know what is a fog. It is also a cloud family. It is a cloud at or very close to the surface. The impact of fog is nothing but reduction of visibility. When the humidity level is more than 85% and the visibility is less than 1000 meter, we say that the reduction is caused because of the hydrometeor, and in this category we call as fog. Fog is caused by atmospheric phenomena like stability, high humidity and hygroscopic nuclei, of which this high humidity also settles, and then it is not rising, and then it settles as a low cloud at or close to the surface. Fog also can form over smoke, because smoke has affinity for water. When fog forms over smoke, it is called as smog. Smoke plus fog equal to smog. Usually in the winter period, smog can be seen. The direct impact of fog is delay in the aircraft operation, passenger inconvenience, diversions, associated loss, especially when the passengers have to be put up in some hotel or they have to be given some food and other expenditure. So there is a direct and indirect impact of fog, especially in aviation operation. The fog, once it is formed, especially in the tropical belts, especially the low latitudes near the equator, it will be dispersed off the moment sun's incoming rays, they churn the fog to dissipate. Whereas in the extratropical latitude and the northern latitude like Delhi, Jaipur, Amritsar, etc., during winter the sun is at the southern hemisphere, and then thereby the fog is not getting dissipated even up to 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock local time. The effects of fog, as we already discussed, reduction in visibility and then decision making is very difficult, and there will be delay and monetary loss. Now coming to the aviation meteorological requirements on economic benefit, we need to give a cautioning and then alert signal for convective storms, associated turbulence and microbursts, clear air turbulence, low level wind shear, icing and vertical visibility. A forecast which is having a validity for the next 3 to 30 hours, which we call a short term forecast, we will be giving. And for the landing operation, we will be providing something called a trend forecast, which in meteorological sense we used to call as nowcast. Early warning of all these phenomena, that will be giving a reaping out of economic benefit of meteorology. In regard to the forecasting services, we give forecasts which has validity somewhere between 9 hours and 30 hours, which we call as terminal aerodrome forecast. By abbreviation we used to say TAF. The 9 hours TAF is applicable for the domestic operation, and then 30 hours TAF is applicable for the international operation. To decide the takeoff gross weight as well as planning for the takeoff, a takeoff forecast with a 3 hours lead time is provided. Then for vectoring of the aircrafts, especially for landing as well as the takeoff operations from an airport or to an airport, we give local and area forecast, which has a validity of 8 hours and which covers a region of 100 nautical miles from the airport concerned. The trend forecast, which I said as landing forecast under the category of nowcasting, it is for the landing operation. Coming to the warning and alert services, we issue aerodrome warning, which has a maximum period of validity as 4 hours, that is only for the airport concerned. We give SIGMET warning, significant meteorological warning, which has a maximum validity of 4 hours, and in the case of tropical cyclone and volcanic ash as an exception, it is for 6 hours. Wind shear and alert is another service we are providing as an alert service. Now, coming to the economic benefit of meteorology, the short term forecast as well as the warning was assessed over 4 aerodromes, and it was estimated that $24.4 million have been saved thanks to the meteorological science and then forecast. Under the category of aerodrome warning, the phenomena for which aerodrome warning we are issuing that have been shown on the right hand side, and this is meant only for the local airport concerned, that will not be disseminated to the outside world. The air traffic controller of the particular airport, he will be using it as an airport operator to regulate, and he will also be passing on to the pilot for safe landing operation. A bigger dimension warning is called a SIGMET warning, which has a validity normally of 4 hours, but for the exceptional case of 6 hours in the case of tropical cyclone and volcanic ash, but it is exchanged to the neighboring flight information region FIR, and the phenomena for which they are issued, they have been shown on the left hand side, right from tropical storm up to tropical revolving storm, that is cyclonic storm, then severe land squall, heavy hail, severe icing and turbulence, marked mountain wave, widespread sandstorm and dust storm, volcanic ash, above all in the recent time radioactive material has been included. Dear students, so far in the last 30 minutes or so, we have been discussing over the importance of the meteorological parameters for the safe, efficient, effective conduct of flights, and the way in which the flights depend on the meteorological information, such as the current weather information, the forecast right from 3 hours to 30 hours, and the warning and alerts which are of safe, efficient, effective conduct of flight operations. And this particular science, especially right from the takeoff and climb out phase to the cruising phase up to the descent and landing phase, they are having effective economic benefit of meteorology. Thank you.